And I will take 30, 35 minutes with Mr. Karwal. I can't see you, Rajiv Karwal sahab. Yes, now I can see you.
That can you hear me now?
Yes, handsome face was missing. So while I have my questions, please park your questions on YouTube, on Global Talent TV, on Facebook and Zoom. For the attendees on Zoom, I will still have an opportunity that I will give you an opportunity to ask questions yourself. But you can write your questions in the Q&A section. I think that should be fine. In the meanwhile, I see a lot more people joining. Ashish Jindal has already joined. I see Naseeba Akhtar from UNDP. She has also joined. So I see a lot of people already in. So let's get going on, you know. I see Ravinder Kachu. I see Tina Bhatt joined already. So let's go on questions. So that is the format. And please write down your questions. Rajiv Karwal sahab, we all know that you are a very successful business leader of this country who has impacted many businesses, stakeholders, as well as employees, leadership, governing boards of various companies and institutions you work for. And you were associated where you yourself have become a brand. But before I go to that, I want to see your young child, Rajiv Karwal, from that Kendriya Vidyalaya, moving from Kanpur to Hyderabad to Baghdoda to GMN College, and then doing so much, cricket captain, hockey captain, and of course declared as most handsome Mr. GMN 1982. So from that childhood, what was your journey during childhood? How did this leadership excellence came into you? So I would like to know about your journey as a child, Rajiv.
Yeah. So, you know, first let me just say, Bakshi sahab, the kind of introduction which you have given, I have not had this kind of an introduction ever in my life. So with tremendous gratitude, you know, I accept every word what you have said, and I also really admire the kind of detailing which you have done in terms of, you know, finding out, you know, tiny nuggets of whatever I did in my career. So thank you very much. You know, as a child, I was the second child of you know, my parents. My father was in the Indian Air Force, and my mother was a homemaker. My sister is elder to me by about 2.5 years. And so we were a small, happy, you know, family. And since my father was in the Air Force, we kept on moving around from one place to another every 2 to 3 years. We also saw the wars, you know, with at that point in time, since my father was in the Air Force. So he, from 62 to, I am 63 born, but from 62 to 65 to 71 wars, my father participated in every war. And since my parents were also from Pakistan, both of them had migrated. So, you know, I also could see the scars of the partition sometimes coming up in the discussion. Both my parents were uprooted and, you know, kind of had to come and find root again. My father's family was a very one. My father actually had, you know, 9 brothers and sisters. And between him and the younger, you know, the son, there was a difference of about 20 years. Ooh. So you know, it was a very wonderful journey where one could experience different places, different cities, you know, and very early on, one could experience the various aspects of a large family management, a lot of marriages taking place, a lot of relatives coming from everywhere, and, you know, kind of building relationship with every kind of people, every age, etc. So I think that really had a very big impact. And till today, you know, I think, you know, to build relationships and merge in any situation, I think now it comes naturally to me. You know, I can talk to the senior most in the world and the junior most, you know, on earth, or, you know, someone who would not even be able to speak. I'm able to communicate and establish a rapport with most of the people. But I think that has to come from the family, you know, experiences. It was a very loving family, you know, and we kind of kept on going. As I, you know, then went to college, then at that point in time, the choices of what one has to do in life, you know, those too many opportunities, was not very rich, you know, because in the Air Force, the income at that point in time was also limited. My sister also had to be married, and my father had always contributed to the various marriages, because there were only two brothers, one the senior most and one the junior most, and in between all were, you know, sisters. So my father had to contribute to, you know, the various marriages in the family. And so we did not have a huge bank balance or something like that. So private sector was out of question in terms of, say, doing MBA or engineering colleges, you know, when we started to look out. And my the force, she had a tremendous amount of, you know, as when the war was on. So she said, become a doctor, you know, father said, become an engineer. So my heart was either in the armed forces or, you know, I said, then I'll do something like MBA or something like that. And I would have been nations, and I was going to the GMN to take my character certificate. And as I was coming out, you know, with my certificate, I was on my Lambretta scooter, and one ambassador car hit me from behind. A lady was Delhi for their use time in every entrance examination. And I lay down on the bed and I couldn't get up. And, you know, for next 3 months, I was completely on the bed. I had a, you know, lower lumbar or the spinal fracture. And that kind of put me behind. And with the kind of, you know, worry which we had in terms of the expenses in private sector, at that time, there were the three IIMs and XLRI was there. Jamnalal Bajaj was there. You know, I missed all the dates. And I used to cry a lot at that point in time that I'll be left behind, you know, all my friends will go ahead. And at that point in time, my family gave me a tremendous amount of strength, and all my, you know, friends were all besides me, and all those friends are still my friends, you know, and we have wonderful, you know, relationship with each other. Even yesterday we were, you know, just talking, and those brought you on. My sister prodded me on and said that, never give up, you know, the family is always with you. But at that point in time, you know, the leadership aspect, which you talked about, really started to take root. I resolved that, you know, I may have lesser genius or lesser IQ than many people, or lesser privileged background than many people, but, you know, no one will find me short in terms of effort, hard work, because, you know, I don't understand smart working, you know. Smart working is there. It is important. But even for smart working, when you want to accomplish a lot, you know, you have to do the hard work. You can prioritize, you know, but if you want to accomplish a lot, you cannot say that I'm doing smart working and now out of 10 things which I have to do, I will do smartly 3 only and 7 I will not do. So it was at that point in time. And slowly, you know, I realized that, when I was on the bed, most of the opportunities went a begging, and only IIMT Ghaziabad was there, and it was a newly formed, you know, MBA school. And then it was expensive. my father still said, you know, I'll sponsor you. Don't worry about anything, you know. Don't worry about whether we have sufficient to support you or not. I am going to support you. And that still today, I think, is, you know, I have so much gratitude to my family for them, because if they would have taken some other decision, maybe my career would have become something else, you know. But they supported me, and then that was the last time they supported. I then, you know, got scholarships and I did extremely well. But when we passed out, there were not too many opportunities which were there. You know, either it was again government, or there were, you know, some, whether you are a marketing specialist or whether you are a finance specialist or an HR specialist, you could only become, you know, a salesperson, you know, and because the top rung was either some of the, you know, FMS was there, Punjab University MBA was there, and the three XLRIs, etc. I mean, three IIMs and XLRI, general. So we were a B grade institute at that point in time. But I said, you know, that is not acceptable to me. I got a job from the space. Then I take it. I went to NIDA, you know, applied on my own, and finally got selected. And I resolved that I will wear my history on my sleeve. I will never hide I am from IMT. I will never hide I am from Kendriya Vidyalaya. I will never hide anything of my past, you know. And that is how, with sheer hard work, and believe me, even today, I'm not someone who has the highest IQ, but I can tell you that with my effort, I will be able to gain that knowledge, that even today, youngsters in my office, in my factory, you know, sometimes can feel that I can compete with them in terms of the knowledge, because of the time I invest in reading and understanding it.
Beautiful. What a fascinating childhood. By the way, are you on an internet? Are you on hotspot? Because your connection is going away in between. You have an internet?
So internet is very bad. So let me just change the internet. If you give me 2 minutes, yeah. I will just change
the hotspot.
Okay. I'll do that.
We miss you in between.
Okay. I'll just do that.
Yeah, I'll wait.
I'm putting it on the hotspot, so.
Yeah, that's better.
Is it better now?
Yeah, now it's better. Okay. We lost you in between.
Yeah.
Fascinating journey. Parents from Pakistan, you know, father from Air Force. So I think the discipline must have come because of the Air Force background.
Oh, yes.
Having this accident and then having this back problem and then fighting it out. Even if we don't get IIM, even if we don't get XLRI, IMT Ghaziabad. And he is talking about hard work. I mean, that is the mantra, what he has given us. Yes, there is a need of smart work, but in case you keep on working hard, you will certainly reach to the ladder of success. It is not necessary to be an IIM graduate or an IIT engineering graduate. It is where there is a dill, there is a will. And where there is a will, there is a dill. He had a heart of excellence. And that is where he earmarked himself to be doing something different. Mr. Karwal, it's fascinating. We all have gone through these stories, you know, and you just, our lives. And tomorrow we have a very big launch. We are launching tomorrow Global Kashmiri Pandit Business Foundation globally. And it's going to be a historical day for us. The 22nd of October, 1947 onwards, you know what has happened. My grandfather was killed by Kabbalis in 1947 and then, you know, 1989. So when I see your, those painful days, you made it to gain. So you turned that pain into gain by hard work. My next question, Rajiv, when I see you as a career leader of over 3.5 decades now, and let me go to you in corporate world. I have to divide this question into two parts. One is which covers initial part of your Onida, Chelsen and LG. You impacted those days, the people still remember you and your leadership marketing traits. These three journeys, which made you to be different as compared to others who were available in the market in terms of marketing sales heads. And you impacted changing the gears and building sustainable brands at that point of time. Can you give us what were the bottlenecks? What were the challenges building those excellence models? I was the head of human resources at Luxor Parker at that time. And I remember when, I mean, Mr. Jain used to take about Rajiv Karwal, LG ko dekho. And I had later a lot of people from LG. I want to tell you.
Yeah. So,
you know, it was such a powerful Rajiv Karwal around. And I used to, you know, those days we did not have much of social media and all that, but we knew that there's great Rajiv Karwal. What were those challenges and how did you break those challenges during that period?
So I think it's a wonderful question. And, you know, I will keep in mind the younger audience, you know, if it is there in good numbers, so that they can benefit from this answer. So when I was, when I joined Onida, you know, at that point in time, you know, I was actually immature, you know, I would, jaise, you know, in Hindi, you say, goli dena, you know, I would do that quite often. And even prior to that, you know, I used to tell a lot of lies also, you know, for no rhyme or reason. So when I was passing out, you know, from IMT and I was doing this sensitivity analysis and we had a very good HR professor and he kind of told me to write my 5-year plan and things like that. And then I said, you know, and he also recommended, you know, this two, three books, you know, one is Games People Play, I'm Okay, You're Okay by Thomas Harris, you know, Staying Okay. And one book which really impacted me tremendously was Jonathan Livingston Seagull, which even till today, you know, is one of the Bibles which I consider, you know, in terms of accomplishment. Whenever I feel down, I just go back to that book. So I started to write a small diary, you know, that today I told 5 lies. Now I've gotten down to 4 lies and 3 lies. You know, it was not the lies to gain anything. It was just, kisi ne pucha bhi raat tak, raat ko kitne baje tak pade the? Nahin, main toh 11 baje so gaya tha. Maybe I slept at 1 o'clock, you know. So, you know, these were, you know, stupid lies which one used. So I controlled that. I worked quite a bit, you know, in terms of what are the personality issues which I have and how I can improve. Second, you know, both my 5-year plan, you will not believe I kind of applied a lot of mind to it. When will I get married? What will be my first, you know, accomplishments which will be there? How many children will I have? I did those kind of dialogues with my would-be wife. And we almost accomplished, because when you think about something, you know, it goes to the subliminal level, in your subconscious mind. And then your body, mind, everything works towards making you achieve those. When I joined, you know, Onida, I wanted to be, you know, not left behind. I, you know, kind of like any middle class guy who has come up to a particular stage and bus mein chad rahe ho, daud karke to koni maar karke aage badhoge, you know, aap. So that also, that attitude I continued in the corporate world, ki bhai aage jana hai, you know. So I remember at that time, it was a very funny, you know, example. One Mr. Sood joined Onida from Blue Star. He was experienced, and there was another Sadarji, Indra Mohan Sahai, you know, he was also a wonderful guy. And I was this young guy, first MBA joining this thing. And when Mr. Sonu Michandani, you know, asked us to do some sales, I said, you know, sabse zyada mujhe sale karni hai, right? And chale gaye, video TV aaye nahi the, video kaise us waqt, I remember now, video kaise bechne ke liye gaye. So there used to be video libraries, you know. And I said, you know, sale to karni hai sabse zyada, to video kaise usko de diye, company ki policy thi, no credit. I said, you know, I have to sell, next day morning I have to get the highest marks from my boss. And paisa khud I had little bit money in my pocket. I deposited to the accounts department and said, "Main to sab kuch bhej diya." You know, now I got the YY also, you know, and a lot of appreciation from my bosses and this thing. Next day afternoon, I went to that, party to whom Nitin Video Library in Janakpuri. That guy said, which products, you know? I was a student who had just come out, did not have the money, you know, I almost cried. But I worked on that guy for almost 8-10 hours, got the money in the middle of the night. And that day I decided that no credit ever to anybody. And I still follow that practice. No, nothing to claim when you have not actually accomplished it. So I follow that. So every such thing which happened in my life, I took that learning and I kind of said, now this is a decision for me. You know, I remember Mr. Sonu Mijandani once, took me to a dealer meet and he said, give a speech. You will not believe, Mr. Bakshi, I had darkness in front of my eyes. I felt I will just, you know, fall unconscious. But I had very good product knowledge. And till today, even yesterday, I was telling my team, if you have the product knowledge, nobody can beat you. Whatever product, whether it is service also, you need to have that knowledge about that is also a product. And if you don't have product knowledge, you will sell relationship basis. Bhai, mere le lo, main aapko janta hoon, ye hai, wo hai. Or you will say price card deta hoon. You know, after doing the price cutting and relationship selling once, what will you sell? You know the product, right? You exploit it. But fortunately, when Mr. Sonu Mijandani told me, I had learned the product. I just kept something. A darkness in my front of my eyes, but I could see people, you know, appreciating the product knowledge. And at the end of it, Mr. Sonu Mijandani gave an appreciation to me. But that day, I also resolved one more thing, that this is the last time I have gotten nervous in a public speaking exercise. I worked upon my knowledge. I said, I have to internalize knowledge. If I have to internalize, I never have to memorize. This is a slogan which I gave to even my company. If you internalize, you have to memorize. When you go there, Saraswati aapki zuban pe aakar ke bolegi, right? So these are some of the things which I, you know, did carried on. And then another thing, you know, it is a general learning, but it is very important for people that, you know, companies can buy skills. Companies can teach skills, right? So skills can be taught, skills can be bought, but a mentality of ownership can neither be taught nor it can be bought. And that is what I brought to every company where I went, an ownership mindset. Ye meri company hai. Iske liye jaan lagana hai. Mujhe nahi chinta karni. I don't have to worry what the competitors will say. I don't have to fight as if I lose my job in this company, will my competitor take me or not? I don't have to fear anything. I must own my company. And that is, you know, what kind of carried through. There were lots of challenges, you know, in various companies. I can talk about them. But I think some of these learnings are something which, if the youngsters are listening, they should really, you know, resolve that with this kind of attitude, nobody can beat you.
Wonderful. When you internalize, you don't need to memorize. Yeah. You know, that is what the, mantra is. I think, yes. Mr. Karwal, what you have done at every stage of your learning, you have created an SOP for yourself. Yes. You created an SOP, you went to next level of excellence. In other words, what you did is that you either win or learn, you never failed. And that is the mantra. You learn, you win, and you never fail. Even if well, it is learning opportunity. Fascinating. I think your mantras are real life learning mantras. In fact, Mr. Karwal, when this entire journey of DNA of leadership will finish December 2021, I will come out with a digital book. Entire world will see all these near about 65 programs by December 2021. And even now, after this program today, it goes to various places and every day viewership is increasing. So it's going to all levels of people. It's going to business owners. It's going to Future World, which I call youngest town of India. Indianization, I talk about. It's going to the youngest town. It's going to be business owners, professionals. So everywhere it's going to be. So you are each and every mantra. And I tell you, is actually a lot of learning for me. I'm an ordinary HR person. There are people, friends who are there already, you know, they know me, Ravinder Kashu is there. There's my friend from Gillette, we work together. And, you know, I'm an ordinary man, but with an only extraordinary.
No, you're not ordinary, you know. You're not ordinary. In this last maybe 30, 40 minutes, I have learned so much from you. You know, the way you have prepared, the way you have prepared for this session itself tells a lot, and so many people can learn from you that, you know, if you are going into a meeting, if you're going into a session, it is all about preparation, what you want to get out of it, what you want your audience to get out of it. Mr. Bakshi, if people are watching and if they are like sponges, you know, they can absorb so much from you the way you have prepared for this session.
I always believe if you fail to prepare, be prepared to fail.
Yeah, exactly.
Fail to prepare, be prepared to fail. Yes. So we cannot be prepared to fail. So I got your thoughts, which you have turned into actions very strongly. So I'm not going now for your corporate experience. I think enough. You have actually done lot of things what you have done in the corporate world. And I tell you, and I used to even few years back also, I used to tell Yasho Verma, even later this HR director, he also moved now, Umesh Dal. Here, there's Mr. Karwal. The finally, I got connected to you. I'm so excited. And I, you know, my elder son who came from London, he worked for LG for 2 years, top task master LG, but he learned a lot. Still, he's saying that I learned a lot from LG. And I have done a lot of training programs in LG. Yeah. I have done a roadmap to success. I must have trained around 500 managers in LG India. And I know what kind of pressure, what kind of numbers. In fact, last face-to-face program was also done in LG in India in February with manufacturing Mr. Kim and his team. And fantastic. Yeah. Ajib Karwal sahab, what made you to think to be getting to your own business entrepreneurship? How did it happen? I am looking at your dream company, Milagro. What is this Milagro? What name? And what impacted you? What made you to think about from a very strong background of corporate world, getting into, I call it blood, sweat, and tears. Business entrepreneurship is blood, sweat, and tears. Yesterday also, one of my colleagues from Thailand called me and he said, no, I want to go to my business. I said, you're getting these dollars, keep it with you. Be happy with your job. In case you are ready for blood, sweat, and tears, then get into business entrepreneurship. So can you give us a quick story of tough? It must have been tough, difficult in the initial stages, but today, Milagro is a brand, number one brand. And people around the world must know Mr. Ajib Karwal's number one brand of robots, service robots, number one brand. I am your brand ambassador. I have been in many companies. I am also your brand ambassador. So that's a fact. And I feel proud to see a gentleman who's so humble. He's talking about his normal lifespan and how did he grow, irrespective of odds. And then creating this, how did it happen? I'm more keen on this business entrepreneurship. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, you know, that I'll tell you, what happens is that when you invest in your knowledge tremendously, when you start believing in yourself, you know, then what happens is that somewhere at a certain point in time, you are not able to accept ordinary coaches or lesser bosses. Absolutely. In a way, you kind of make yourself unemployable, you know. Not that your market value is less, But you kind of, you know, it is, because what happens is money was a driver for me, but it was not money for living life for money's sake. You know, you can pick out my history. You will never find Rajiv Karwal in a page three situation, you know, or a page three presence has made my career. Never. It is only about my work, about my professionalism, about my contributions to my company, and a few, very few friends and my family. This is what is important to me in my life. There is nothing else which is important. So when Electrolux, which was a very difficult turnaround case, was happening, and when I actually took up the Electrolux case, a lot of my friends and a lot of, you know, people told me, nobody is touching Electrolux even with a barge pole because it is a gone case. You know, you cannot turn it around. And I said, no, I will turn it around. And I have managed to turn around Philips. You know, I have done LG, and if I have grown in my life, it is only because of the challenges which I have accepted, right? So at that point in time, I took up the Electrolux challenge, and there was, you know, to pick up the people was so difficult. People were not willing to join, you know. There was such a huge amount of credit. There were quality issues. And on top of it, you know, a company like LG, where I had worked before, we had kind of, you know, fortified every aspect of the appliances business where I was there, you know, ki that koi jagah nahi chhodi thi for air conditioners, anybody to get in, or in washing machines, or, you know, microwave ovens. We had done such a good strategy at this thing. So nobody gave us, you know, a chance, but I said, no, we'll still do it, you know. And it is not that we did anything with animosity towards LG or anything of that sort. I was realizing and self-actualizing, etc. So we were hitting every number. We were doing wonderfully well. And it was, you know, the industry was recognizing it, and we had built a very wonderful team. And then Electrolux worldwide was weakening, because Electrolux worldwide was also coming under tremendous amount of pressure from LG Samsung. So was Whirlpool worldwide, you know. So LG Samsung was growing worldwide, and Electrolux, you know, had two businesses. One was Husqvarna and one was Electrolux. And Husqvarna was very professional equipment and very, very profitable, and its consumer appliances business was making huge losses almost everywhere. So they wanted to separate the two businesses, and they wanted to transfer a lot of cash to the Electrolux business because they knew that it will require a lot of turnaround money. But if they would not have taken up certain harsh measures, then, you know, it would have become an easy takeover target. So they wanted the share price to rise, and that the management means business. And to identify, India had the least amount of exit rules for any multinational, right? And although China was making 10 times more losses than India, and China was not hitting any target, which business got sacrificed? India business got sacrificed. My team, I fought tooth and nail. We, even the management team, bid for a takeover for the India business. We said, give it to us, we will run it. But somehow, you know, it did not. That actually broke my heart, you know. And at that point in time, you know, this ownership mentality, which we talk about, is something, you know, which I said, you know, ownership mentality, yes, but an employee is still an employee, because sometimes decisions will get taken by the owners of the business, which they may be right at their, you know, position, but I do not want to be in this position ever again, because we were so near. Believe me, today Electrolux you don't see anywhere in the country. And in hindsight, I feel I was right. We were doing so well. And the team, which is still in touch with me, we all feel it was a mission half accomplished. We could have really, really, you know, gone ahead and created huge success out of that turnaround. And that day I decided that I will, you know, do something on my own. You mentioned about the Reliance thing. So I actually never wanted to join Reliance. And there was, you know, a call which came. I knew Mr. Mukesh Ambani because I was the president of SIAMA, which is the Consumer Electronics and Appliances Manufacturers Association. When a call comes from Mr. Ambani, nobody will not go, you know. So you have to go. I went there. I had not said yes. I came out and there was, you know, this girl, Chaitali Chakravarti from Economic Times, and she will still remember. I told her, please, Chaitali, don't write about this thing that I'm joining Reliance. I pleaded to her. But next day morning, front page of Economic Times said the poster boy of consumer electronics to join Reliance Retail, you know. And now that story hit. I was in a situation, my children were to go to the US, both the students, both were 12, one was in 12th, one was in 11th. We were not in a position to move our family. It was a tough situation. So, but then it was a public position which was taken by Economic Times. It would have really hurt the image of Reliance or, you know, anybody else. So I said, okay, 1 year, I will put my life on hold. It was only after Electrolux that I wanted to start Milagro. But then I said, okay, I'll put my life on hold for 1 year, go there. I discussed with Mr. Ambani. I joined in January. I discussed this in February with him that this is the situation. He said, please stay here for as long as, you know, I want you to, because if you leave at this point in time, a lot of people are coming and, you know, it will not be good for our image. So I said, sir, I'm not going to do anything to serve anybody else. I'm going to do something on my own. I'm willing to put my life on hold for you. I just want one commitment from you. That is that if I'm here, you will trust me till the last day. You will give me the independence to work. If you don't give me the independence to work and you will not trust me, I'm not going to stay. Even if I'm going to stay, you are not going to benefit. I'm not here for image sake. I will work. And he kept his word till the last day. I really enjoyed my stint at Reliance. And we were ahead of all the business formats. And today also Reliance Digital is doing extremely well. So my stint in Reliance was short because of that. And, you know, today, you know, when I look back, it is very simple. Have an ownership mindset. Work with that ownership mindset. But the day you feel that you are unemployable by anybody, that day has come to become an entrepreneur or do something on your own. So... And it is also, you know, not that you can say that with ownership mindset, you have known everything. Bakshiji, I had the toughest time in doing the business. It was Bhagwan, aap se sare decision karwata hai aur phir maze dekhta hai, right? So I chose this entrepreneurship journey. And I thought that, you know, as a business head, and having traveled so much, every nook and corner of the country, I know this country. Believe me, I knew only 10% of what I know now. I used to go as a big executive from LG or Philips or Reliance or Electrolux. Apna man se kya kuch malum nahi ki that Meerut mein aur kya kya hai. Apne dealer ke paas gaye, kuch speech de di usko, usne bhi aakar aapko izzat kar di. Aapne matlab ki baat kari ya nahi kari. Whether you are talking sense or not. That guy will still, you know, give you respect just because you're coming from a big organization. Although I was sensitive, I, you know, but I never knew India the way I know now, you know. Whether you're talking sense or not, that guy will still, you know, give you respect just because you're coming from a big organization. Although I was sensitive, I, you know, but I never knew India. There's a time, I think there's a lag, I think. Are you able to hear me, Mr. Bakshi?
Yeah, we're able to hear.
Okay, so, you know, that is where I realized that I have so much to learn. I have to, you know, really invest in myself. So much more knowledge has to be created, and becoming an entrepreneur from a successful professional is not easy. You know, a lot of people raise a lot of money. I said, no, I want to start small. I want to, you know, climb the stairs because I do not want to do a business where I have a 2000 crore turnover and I have a 2000 crore loss and I built a community and then I will, you know, achieve that success or say that I have achieved a lot. I want to do the business in an old fashioned way where, you know, we invest, we are profitable, we invest, we are profitable. Customer is the best financier of your business. Even today, we have no money from outside. We have zero debt from any bank. We have internal accruals. We have passed through tough times, but we have chosen an industry which is going to grow for the next 100 years. And 1 or 2, 3 years of slow growth doesn't really matter. So, and it took a pandemic to actually increase the demand of robots, but it's fine. An idea whose time has come, you know. So God teaches you a lot of things. Entrepreneurship is not easy. You really need to have nerves of steel.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I fully agree with you. I can see that. I can see my picture in you. And how did I do it? Leaving an expat job, people did not believe. Even my managing director, how can you leave the job? One son is already in London and other son is going to Canada to study. You're a rich man. I am not a rich man. But then I said, my passion will drive me.
Yes.
And then beautiful story, beautiful journey. Mr. Karwal, I have had a lot of discussions with people who have worked for you in various companies. I had discussions with some of the people who are part of your Milagro present business, which you founded and funded. You know, I was told that you're a very humble, down-to-earth person. And you have a leadership style of being simply, beautifully elegant, humane. But you are very tough taskmaster. Your agility for business and business competitiveness is very high. And another thing which I was told by somebody from LG as well as Electrolux, that your review mechanism of business when you do a review is not ordinary. It's very strict, stringent. And as a business leader, you are very clearly looking for numbers, 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 numbers. Of course, with compassion, with humility, but your agility is high. Also, I got tips that during COVID, your business started growing more. That's fine. But then there are many businesses which are struggling. You know, we can't have, you know, BC. We are in DC now. And we don't know when the AC will come. And those businesses which are struggling right now, what is your message to them in terms of business leadership as a business leader?
You see, now there are two or three things. You know, people who worked for me, say in Electrolux or LG or Philips, you know, have to understand that there are different leadership styles which one has to adopt for different situations of an organization or for different responsibilities or different hats which you are wearing. So if it is a startup situation, you basically have this leadership style where you catch your organization by the scruff of the neck and say, follow me, I'll tell you the way, right? Because it's a startup situation. Same situation is good for turnarounds also. But for scaling up, you require a different kind of a leadership style, you know, which is more humble, which is more team building, etc. But turnaround and startups, you have no time to waste. You want to really have to, because idea has to be taken forward. So, and in a mature business, you require a different kind of a relation, you know, leadership. So that is about the stage of a business. Now, if you are a sales and marketing head, you require a different kind of a leadership style. And if you are an HR head, you require a different kind of a leadership style. I always say this thing that marketing is the art of getting into the heart through the mind, right? And HR is the art of getting into the mind through the heart, okay? So if you actually are wearing a different hat, you will require to have a different leadership style. So different people would see different aspects of me at different stages of an organization or different, hats which I'm wearing. Another thing is that as you age, you also become more knowledgeable, you become more humble, you kind of have gone through different situations, you know, tough times. So if you were to say, you know, like my career went up and up and up and up, right? And then Electrolux happened. My heart was broken. Then I decided Milagro. I struggled in Milagro, right? So it is not that at that point in time, my worth was less. I've never questioned my worth, right? I knew what I was doing, but market was not ready. I took the decision to get into that. But that struggle, you know, not that you have questioned your self-worth. You see it in other people's eyes. Arre, Mr. Karwa, aap to bahut bade kaam kar rahe the, aaj itna chota sa kaam kar rahe ho. Arre, Mr. Karwa, aapko PR mein nahi dekhte. You know, that is the way the world will look at you. So it doesn't matter. You have to have confidence in your own, you know, abilities as to what you are, and then have the resilience to come back. A good leader is someone who can survive geographies. A good leader is someone who can survive decades. A good leader is someone who can straddle industries. A good leader is someone who can straddle various functions of management, right? And that is where you require to continuously invest in yourself to stay relevant to a situation. Agar aap अपने अंदर इन्वेस्ट करना बंद कर देंगे ना, आप नीचे आएंगे इमीडिएटली. सो नेवर सिट बैक ऑन योर लॉरल्स टिल द टाइम यू नो सचिन तेंदुलकर इज प्लेइंग, ही हैज टू बी द बेस्ट प्लेयर. जिस दिन उसने डिसाइड कर लिया कि भाई अब बस, उस दिन उसको रिटायर हो जाना चाहिए. सेम थिंग फॉर MS धोनी और फॉर एनीबडी एल्स, यू नो. It time comes. So I want to, today my mindset is I want to work till the last day of my life. And that is why I continuously invest in myself. Maybe a time, if it changes, mindset changes, it will be a different Rajiv Karwal, which you will see.
Great. You know what's happening? You have engaged us so much. I have to ask questions from the public also. I will take a quick two questions and quick two answers. You have been doing so much for the business. And then you have been doing so much for the association, CII, FICCI, IMT Association, and talking about business schools and all that. What is your motivational pit and how do you manage this? Quick response.
Okay, so, you know, it is very, very important to have gratitude for, people or places or organizations or your educational, you know, or alma maters who have contributed to your success. I have just one motto, that jab aapko zarurat thi, when you needed someone, if somebody stepped forward and helped you, played an important role in your life, never let them down.
Wow.
You may still end up letting people down because their expectations may not match what you can contribute to them, but make a genuine effort to help and respond. Aaj bhi aap ye dekho ki that agar aap kahin duvidha mein ho, kahin bahut badi problem mein ho, aur agar aap awaaz lagate ho aur aap 50 logon ko awaaz lagate ho aur 3 log aate hain, for those 3 people give your life. Because when you needed them, they were there. Kuch bhi ho jaye, uska ethics alag ho, uski corruption ho, kuch bhi ho, but wo banda aapke liye aaya na, uske liye jaan lagao. Don't compromise your ethics. Try to reform him. But where he needed you, stand by that person.
Wow, fantastic. I always say, work together, learn together, earn together, dance together, eat together, sleep together, but cry together when person needs. To give him your shoulder. Fascinating. You're making me to learn. One more question. You're a sportsman. Cricket, hockey, blah, blah, blah. I have also been a sportsman. And we have, even Siddiqui and me, we have done a lot of corporate cricket tournaments in Delhi, where I used to work in India way back 2002. So has cricket given you some leadership techniques and skills and this hockey, this sports?
No, see, sports, may there is so much to learn from sports. You see, today when you watch the IPL, you know, and believe me, I am watching most of the matches, okay? And every day it is my routine. I check the table before I sleep. I check who has scored the most runs and who is where in the hierarchy. I see who has taken the most wickets, who has scored the most sixes, etc., etc. And then I sleep every day.
Wow.
Why? Because the people who are playing today, if a Rahul is leading the table and a Shikhar Dhawan is coming up very quickly with two back-to-back centuries, right? Then both of them are giving 100% of their abilities. It's a given. But one is giving 160%. Another may be giving 158%, right? In sports, when you compete amongst champions, you realize that giving 100% is not enough. You realize that what you learned till yesterday is not enough.
Wow.
You realize that aaj maine haath dekh liya, kal to haath dekha tha yaar, aaj jeet li gayi thi. और आज मैं हार गया, अरे लाइन चेंज हो गई थी क्योंकि दूसरे बंदे ने इतनी मेहनत करी दैट आपने मेहनत नहीं करी तो आपकी लाइन चेंज हो गई, कल तक उसने नहीं करी थी मेहनत. सो वन हैज टू लर्न सो मच फ्रॉम द स्पोर्ट. एंड सेकंड इज दैट व्हाट यू सेड, यू नो, अगर आपने ट्राई करा है तो यू नेवर फेल, आइदर यू विन और यू लर्न समथिंग एंड मूव. सेम वे, यू नो, यू आर एज गुड एज योर लास्ट इनिंग्स, यस, but you cannot stop at the last innings. You have to again face the ball. So it's Virendra Sehwag, you know, why is he such a great guy? You know, he did not have the technique, but what, one ball missed, went, he was almost out of the bacha. Next ball, six. Next ball, another six, you know, because he just brushed away the failure. And that is what sportsmen are all about. So if Federer was to say ki yaar main Nadal se itna zyada haar jata hu ab maine Nadal ke sath khelna nahi, right, to aise to life nahi hoti. Aaj dono 20-20 baithe hue hain na, 20 grand slams lekar ke baithe hue hain, both the two people. There is so much to learn from the sport. It is about individuals test of endurance that sports teaches you, you know. That is why I watch sports.
Wonderful. Yeah, that is, sports gives us a lot of leadership skills for sure. And that is what, last question before I go to the public. I see your family, fantastic. God bless them. Two handsome sons like you. You are creating a brand. Are they going to take it forward? Is a big question mark. I have a similar issue. They say your passion and my passion. What is happening with your two sons? Will they take your brand forward?
See, I have two wonderful sons and I really am very, very proud of them. Elder one is called Saksham and the younger one is called Samarth. Of both the names is the same when me and my wife named them, you know. And both of them are doing wonderfully well in their areas which they have chosen for themselves. So the elder one is running a very good business on AI. He is in Calcutta. I am in Gurgaon. And that business is supporting lot of, you know, fashion businesses at the back end for fashion discovery and fashion trends and, you know, a lot of analytical big data and recommendations. So he's enjoying it. And the younger one decided to go into yoga. So now, as parents, sometimes you feel, yaar, ye to hamare jaise nahi hai, ya ye different, you know, kar rahe. So as a family, you have to support the children to realize, you know, their potential, realize their passion, what they really like, right? So when we started Milagro, at that time we discussed as a family that I am going to be the last operating manager of the family in Milagro. We will professionalize it. After me, this company will run professionally. My sons my family will be an investor of the business, right? And they will pursue everything else. So Milagro is there in the last 10 years or 11 years of this company's existence, 2007 onwards, in fact, 13 years, I have not taken a single penny home from this company. Oh. Everything gets invested back into the company, and that is how we are debt free. That is how we don't have require equity from outside, because jis din maine apni value nikalni shuru kar di is company se, us din main to nahi survive hi nahi kar paunga. So that is what. And by the way, I want to share with you and with the audience a very, very good news, that day before yesterday I became a dada.
Wow.
So my elder son and beautiful and wonderful daughter-in-law Sneha, they had a baby boy in Calcutta. So we are all overjoyed, and you know, it's a very loving and
supportive. It's a Navratra gift to you.
Yes.
It's a Navratra gift to you. Milagro. Yes. Wow. I need to go to the questions. Thank you very much, because I always have issues with when I do coaching for a lot of people, their sons, because in Thailand you must be seeing a lot of Thai Indian community are owning hotels and many businesses, but their children are not aligned to them. So I do a lot of coaching with them, and I see a lot of gaps between the passion and the passion. I have a similar issue at Bakshi family with my two sons. I say, as long as I can work, and let's see, and I got a good idea from you. I have a question here, and the first question I see from Naseeba Akhtar, UNDP head. Naseeba, I am allowing you to talk. Please unmute yourself and talk. She's from Bangladesh. Naseeba, you can ask your question, okay. Naseeba. Yes, Naseeba, unmute yourself. Naseeba, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, yes. Hello, everyone.
Yes, everyone.
Hello.
It's really nice to meet you, everyone. And it's really amazing, Mr. Rajiv, to know your history. As I am working on gender research and also in adaptive livelihood, so it's my question, how you like person will contribute onwards to establish the entrepreneurship of women, because you know women have lots of barriers to overcome the path of business, etc., everything, and they are not privileged. Maybe we are fighting, we are talking about the equal right. I never believe on feminism, but actually who want to establish themselves, what is your opinion? What is your suggestion? And in this, your era of success, if you want to contribute any women, who is she?
Okay, so Naseeba ji, Naseeba ji, this is a very wonderful question, and it is a question which is very, very dear to my heart. You know, we got married, and within 1 year of our marriage, we had our first child. And within the 2 years of our marriage, we had our second child. My wife was equally talented, perhaps more talented than me. She was also an MBA. She was working with me at UNIDA. And she had to compromise her career for our family, for the children. And this has always been in my mind. So when I was looking for the business to do on my own, the robots, you know, what is the basic thought process behind it? The basic thought process behind it is that so many educated ladies who are very, very competent compromise their careers because they have to do daily chores and menial tasks at home. And these robots, which we have, the floor cleaning robots, the window cleaning robots. We are working on the, you know, robots which can do the toilet cleaning. We are working on the robots which can do the dishes, right? Which can do the cooking. We are in our R&D, we are working. So just imagine that if one person working for another person for daily chores, for menial tasks, was to be freed that person can contribute so much to the economy. That person can realize so much of potential which they have. So, you know, robots, sometimes people think they will take jobs. No, they are going to free so much of, you know, ladies, especially who are already, and we'll come back to, you know, the other segment also, but who are so much educated, who are not contributing, or they are not part of the workforce to take this nation forward. Second aspect, when you have these kind of, which actually start to go everywhere, the skill sets which are required today, you know, whether it is Bangladesh, whether it is, you know, India, if we have to find our competitiveness vis-a-vis, say, a China, how will we find it? If we want to grow our economy, if we want to grow the GDP, how will we find it? If Germany wants to take back its competitiveness from China, how will they, you know, find their competitiveness with aging population, expensive population, or with economic rules which are there? I will not work for so and so time. I require this, I require that. They are going to have to use automation. They are going to have to use artificial intelligence. They are going to have to use robots, etc. Their skill set of their, you know, their population has to change. The entire way that governments and societies look at education has to change. If India and Bangladesh have to compete with, say, a re-emerging Western world or the USA and a very strong China, we have to change, reimagine our business. And it is not just about one gender, it is about everything. Now coming to the gender issues. Gender issues are not just about education. They are not just about products or services. They are about deep mindsets which exist in our societies. We require role models. We require women to come up with and associate with themselves. Women leaders today in every economy or every society which is decaying are the people who have held the mirror to the world. During this pandemic also, please, you know, don't mind my saying it, but countries which have done extremely well have shown compassion. They've shown empathy. You know, and that is what comes naturally to the women and the women leaders, you know, and that is why today, you know, even in this situation, Bangladesh is showing to the world how to grow, you know, how to make changes in the economy, in the society. So I personally feel that your question is very, very important. We alone or one company alone can't do much. We all have to fight it together. Even the UN has to change, you know, some of the ways in which it makes the interventions, and it has to become more of a societal presence, not just a presence which kind of pushes agenda through the governments.
Thank you so much. You have very
thank good. You.
Naseeba, thanks.
Salaam thank you. Thanks. Walaikum assalam.
So I have now Milani from Spain, and she wants to talk to you. She has some questions. Yes, Milani.
Hello. Hello, DK. Thank you for bringing us such amazing guests. It's been a real pleasure listening to this conversation. So many life and business lessons. And more than a question, I just want to thank you both for the inspiration behind your words always. I agree 100% with everything you've said about entrepreneurship, about leadership. And I love this last question because I do agree again, this, and I love what's happening in the world now, although we are at very, very different stages when it comes to feminism or women power or equality, just equality. But it's great that so many companies, and this is the example today again, are making it a point to bring conciliation to our families. So with these robots, you know, it's just going to be so much easier to be able to conciliate. So thank you very much, Mr. Rajiv. And I just wanted to make a point. In Spanish, milagro means miracle. So that is just a beautiful brand name.
Yeah, Melanie, thank you very much. And, you know, little bit to demonstrate. Yo me puede hablar español un poquito. So I don't have much practice now, but when I was in Spain, I learned Spanish quite a bit. And I still sometimes, you know, see Spanish movies and Spanish, you know, papers. I read, try to keep in touch. And, you know, what I also want to say is that the Spanish society, which I found, although it is a matriarchal society and India is a patriarchal society, but the family ties which I found, you know, which existed in the Spanish society were very, very similar to the Indian society. And I have some of my best friends in Spain, and I really love Spain tremendously, you know, because of the vibrance, exuberance, and compassion and empathy which Spain has, which I don't find in any other European country, frankly.
Yeah, I agree with you. And in fact, Melanie is one of our very powerful women power in Spain. Her own story is only working hard, working hard, working hard. And she became very smart. You see her when she is on her you know, lectures. And now many Indian universities are inviting her to be speakers. Melanie, thank you very much. I have now Vivek Harkoli, well-known business director. He also worked with Mukesh Ambani company for near about 20 years. Then I picked him from there and took him to another part of the PET business, global business director of excellence. Together we worked in many Europeans and American and Asia Pacific country. Last was his Octal as CEO. Yes, Mr. Vivek Harkoli, your question please. I unmuted you.
Good evening, Rajiv. Good evening, DK.
Good evening, Vivekji.
I have with rapt attention listened to your words, and I have had lot of takeaways for what you said. Some of them are, as you said, believe in yourself. Another one is accept challenges. And last, which really took to me, which I took myself, is you said win and there is no failure. Rather, it is learn and move forward. And I think this is what has been my biggest learning today.
Beautiful.
Win, do not consider any failure. Learn and move forward.
Wow.
This is what I think has impressed me a lot. And now I have a question.
Thank you.
Oh, okay. Quick.
The question is, yes, you went through this. You went to become an entrepreneur. What I want to understand is, how did you execute successfully this spirit of entrepreneurship? We all have strategies. We have all have tactics. But people fail. Businesses fail. Because the strategies were good, but the execution was poor. So my question is, how did you execute your strategy, your vision successfully?
So, you know, it's a
Rajivji, very quick response, because we have many questions and we have overshooted the time, but I need to take some questions. Okay. So quick response.
It's a wonderful question, but as an entrepreneur, you know, one has to realize that if one has done good homework and if they were going into a particular business venture, did they identify the market size correctly? Did they identify the profit pool in that market correctly? If they did that correctly, then they must remember then that an idea never fails a person. It is a person who fails the idea, right? So if the original identification of the market was correct and the market has not changed, and you are not finding success, then please look inside and change whatever requires to be changed. Change. You are not a professional working on somebody else's money. You're working on your own money. You know, as long as you are not, you know, the new age entrepreneur with a lot of VC money. So that is a separate matter. And they will either push you towards a pivoting. But if you are working on your own money, pivot very quickly. As an entrepreneur, have, you know, the speed of an eagle or the eye of an eagle. You know, like it snaps and, you know, picks up something. So that's what entrepreneur is all about.
Very great. Thank you so much. I have Aditya Vidyasagar, well-known social sector personality of the country from Lucknow. He does a lot of work for the social sector. Aditya, quick question.
Am I audible?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah.
Great. I mean, it was indeed a pleasure to listen to such a person who, in fact, has made himself himself. He has given me a lot to learn today. And I'm thankful to you, Mr. Bakshi, for identifying and bringing such genius class of people out here who actually achieved something where we need to realize that, yes, here's a guy that, and so much of it that I can pick up from and learn from and move on. And the best thing which I liked about him, that despite having experienced and so much, he has done so much and achieved so much. But one thing which he has mentioned, that move on with a scope of changeability according to the situation, current situation demands. That's something wonderful. No matter who you are, what you have done, but what matters is that what are you going to face now and you have to deal with now, how? That's very inspiring. Thank you so much, Mr. Karwal. I've really been inspired. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Aditya. Yeah. We got Tina Butt, who's these days in Srinagar, Kashmir. Tina, I have unmuted you. You have some question. Tina, are you there?
Oh, hello. Good evening, everyone.
Good, Tina.
I hope you are doing well. Thank you so much, Raji sir. And it's been a great pleasure to be a part of such an enlightening session. And I'm really very glad to hear such inspirational story from your side. And I'm sure this is going to be a great encouragement for all of you. Because as you rightly said, we never fail. We either learn and grow. We always learn from our failures. So presently, the question, in fact, from last some days was striking in my mind. Like, my question is like, how business leaders are actually presenting this society emerging from this COVID era, as we heard a lot about layoffs that are taking place, and it is only Ratan Tata who is not, following the strategy. What about other leaders who are presently laying off many employees who have, there are various emerging issues we are actually facing out of the leadership in such difficult times. And my exact question is how business leaders are helping out the society presently, and which are the presently, who are those world leaders who have actually displayed the effective behavior across cultures to face this difficult situation, to help the society out? I mean, as a leader, how could we contribute towards the society, especially employees who are being getting laid off and all?
Thanks,
it's a very good question, and you are also, young, so I can, see that aspect in your question. So, long time ago, I stopped judging others, what they're doing, what they are not doing, who is doing good, who is doing bad. Stop doing that, because whatever whosoever is doing, it is their karma, and whatever they want to do, howsoever they want to do, leave it. You are in a situation, and if suppose you are getting laid off, and if suppose you are in a situation that, you are not sure whether your company is doing well or you not, you do your best to that extent. A time comes when you have to look out, or you have to see, what should I do at this level? There is so much which you can do. I want to tell you that a lot of us, don't understand that resources cost money, but resourcefulness is free of cost. Resourcefulness is about reaching out, about talking to others, about networking, and then being able to find out a no-cost solution or a beautiful solution out of a most dark, you know, situation in your life. Talk to others, reach out. Don't fold inwards, fold outwards when you are in a difficult situation. Reach out, and there will be, you will realize that in this world, there are much more number of good people than bad people. So reach out, build good relationships, and you would be able to grow. Stop judging others, let them do whatever they want, you know, but you do good for yourself and your surroundings. That is what is important.
Beautiful. I have Anshul Sharma. She is the director of the business school in Nayi, Mumbai, and she is Women Power Mumbai. Anshul.
Yes, thank you so much, and great evening, Karwal sir, Rajiv sir, and Bakshi sir. See, I will not ask question because otherwise it will take a long time. But Rajiv sir, I don't know whether you would be remembering me or not, but I used to meet you while I was working with GLA University Mathura.
Okay.
And Neeraj sir. With Neeraj sir.
Yeah.
And I'll just share, you know, one incident that, you know, knowingly, unknowingly, people like you, the leaders like you, you inspire a lot. See, I and Sudhir Singh, if you remember, Sudhir was also there with us.
Yeah.
He came to your house once. And we kind of, I still remember, I think if I'm not wrong, ma'am's name is Shobha.
Yes.
Right. So, and see, like, it was such a small incident. We came, and then you just, you know, offered some coffee there, and you asked ma'am by name, ki aap Shobha ko lekar aaiye. And we were very young then. And so that memory is still so fresh that, you know, I'm still recalling that. And it's really, I'll just tell all the audience that whatever is being, you know, covered during the entire session, it was just like a movie that is running, and I was glued to, you know, my system and not even blinking eyes. And
one and a half hours, Anshul, and we are still on. Thank you very much for your comment. And Jennifer from Malaysia. Malaysia, bole quick. Jennifer.
All right. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Yeah, okay. I'm Jennifer from Malaysia. Nice to meet both of you. Okay, my question is, how do you reward your staff that working hard for sustaining your organization even during the pandemic, and how do you motivate them? Maybe you can answer me.
Yeah, it's a very, very, very good question. You know, so let me tell you about my company. So we declared the lockdown week before the government of India declared a lockdown, okay? Because we were reading about what is happening in China and Italy and other places. And we said, you know, this is going to happen in India also. Let's go back, work from homes. Although in a product-based business, it is very difficult to do that. And then, you know, when I got some time to think about it, I immediately realized that now is the time for robots to come. Because the day the government of India announced the lockdown, immediately, no domestic servants were allowed. Everything got into a lockdown. When the world was still thinking, I was planning with my team how to take passes, curfew passes to go out. We reached out to, you know, earlier hotels were buying our humanoids. We started to reach out to hospitals because doctors were getting affected. Healthcare workers were getting affected by corona. So, and PPEs were not there, you know, protection kits were not there. So we said, our robots will do the work for you. You can call from wherever. And, you know, at that point in time, I led from the front. I said a leader is someone who has to be seen on the mountaintops. He also has to be seen with his own words in the trenches. That is how you motivate your staff. And the staff also, you don't have to pick up the entire staff to motivate suddenly. You pick up four or five. Those are the people who will magnetize the rest of the staff, right? And within the first week of the lockdown, we went everywhere. And if I still think, you know, I don't have money from any VC. I don't have any loan from the bank. For me, the cash flow is very, very important. If at that point in time, I would have said, oh, what happened? You know, my business would have closed down. And when the world was still planning, we were ordering kits, you know, for assembly. We moved ahead. And there was this one small group of employees who, according to me, are the pillars of this company. And believe me, sometimes the roof says that I am protecting everybody else. And the pillars say that actually, if we were not there, where would be the roof? And believe me, I also consider myself along with my employees as a pillar and not as a roof. Beautiful. Because the pillars is what is most important.
Karwal sahab, beautiful. You have won my heart. Two questions. One is Ash from Australia and then Ravindra Kachru from Bangalore. Ash, quick one.
Hi,
he's in Australia. He's in midnight, but he's there.
So thanks, okay. Rajiv, for your inputs. I have to go back to this recording and hear it again once more because it's so entertaining and so much to learn. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
I think one of the things which you mentioned about is your robotics business. And I would like, now that you're helping people in India with your robotic solution, I would love to have a talk with you and chat about your robotic solution coming over to Australia too. Happy to take some input from you and talk to you further on this. So I don't have any other questions apart from that. So please give me some time and we'll talk on that.
Ash, good night. You are around, I think, 12 midnight.
20 to 12.
Oh, my God. Okay, now last question. Ravindra Kachru from Bangalore. Ravindra has been the manufacturing excellence guy from Parker to a couple of more multinational companies, and he's part of the global talent. Business excellence and manufacturing excellence. Ravindra, your question quick. Last question.
Okay. I am Ravindra here. Hi, Rajiv and Bakshi-san. It was great to listen, both of you. Very patiently, I was listening, you know, which is very difficult for an operation guy, you know, sitting at one place and listening to. But this was so absorbing. I think some of the sessions Bakshi-san has conducted, like Siddiqui-san and yours and some more, it has been fantastic. It has been fantastic. My simple question. See, in all this journey, two things are important, which you talked about. One is changing from, you know, a role, what do you call it, as a hard taskmaster to starting as an entrepreneur. It's a difficult journey, you know, basically. Because once you are you are the head of something, you dictate many of the times, you know. But when you are an entrepreneur, it is a 180 degrees shift. So how did the shift come, number one? Number second, who has been your role model in this particular process as such? And what have you taken, what type, whenever you are in challenging position, what type of, whom do you contact at that particular point of time?
So I think it's a very, very, you know, good, very fantastic question, you know. So what happens is that, you know, as an entrepreneur, people have various styles, you know. Now, my objective is very clear that I am not playing to make fast money or quick money. If I would have that objective, I would have gone into some of the easier product categories. So since my objective is long-term, I'm very clear and at peace. Even if sometimes I make mistakes, my team makes mistakes, or if we have 1 or 2 years of slow growth. So as a result, you know, I always say, build the foundation from the ground up, right? And you have to continuously learn. You have to be like a sponge. And there is a lot of learning from becoming, you know, from a professional to an entrepreneur, where you have to unlearn a lot of things. You have to give up a lot of sense of entitlement and ego that, you know, when I was a Reliance president, this is how I walked into a hotel and people looked at me. This is how, you know, I walked into, you know, some place and people say, oh, so-and-so has come, you know. So slowly this world is actually a Hindustan Times will look at you, or I'm not, please don't hold Hindustan Times. It's just, you know, any other, any media agency or media company will look at you. Oh, this person can give us 500 crores of advertising budget, you know, and when you have 5 crores of advertising budget, obviously, you know, there are priorities. So don't change your attitude towards them. They are doing their job. You are doing your job. You have made your choices. They have made their choices. So stop judging people. And I, for example, because I want to build a very long, you know, future for this company, I have adopted this leadership style of servant leadership. In the sense, I enable people more than I enable people, because that is how I'm building more pillars in the organization who would be the future leaders of this professionally run organization.
Here's the last question I have to take. Sanjay Kumar, he's one of the mad persons, passionate person, talking about everyday India and Thailand, from Navratras to anything and everything. I think he has a question. I'm sorry, I could not hear your question. Ask this question. Yes, Sanjay.
Rajiv ji, thank you so much for I was listening to your lecture since you started. Very informative. I appreciate you and Bakshi ji for bringing this webinar. My quick question to you that I am actually learning a little bit about how robotics can change the defense sector. So could you please update about what's happening and what you think the defense sector in next like 5-10 years? That is my question.
It is one of the most important sectors where, you know, robotics can be used. Actually, if you see, a drone is also a robot, right? If you see, you know, centipedes, which can actually just walk into enemy territory, noticed, actually can do a massive amount of damage in enemy territory, right? Robotics is something which, with artificial intelligence, with their armor, which is unbreakable, can go into any territory. They can be the new age tanks, you know. They can hold ammunition or weapons which an ordinary human being won't be able to, you know, this. Human bodies may not be made to last the vagaries of the weather in Ladakh, for example, but a robot can really be built in such a way that it can last. A human being has an age. It has different amount of needs. Mereko rest karna hai, mujhe sona hai, right? Mujhe entertainment karni hai. A robot will not have those kind of requirements. So a robot has actually a huge amount of bomb disposal, for example. A robot can do a bomb disposal without risking anybody. A robot can do firefighting, you know, without risking anybody. When the nuclear disaster happened in Japan, human beings did not go inside. It was the robots which were sent inside to, you know, take out the gases. So there is so much of potential of robots in the defense sector. India also has a great future in that. You know, we are thinking about that sector also. But some of the key components are right now not made in India. So, you know, once that kind of an ecosystem emerges, I'm sure that, the need is already there. Industry is not ready to, you know, take or fulfill that need of the Indian defense sector.
Wow. You know, Rajivji, you know what has happened? We are at 7:10 IST. We started at 10:30. My God, what an exciting. I mean, we did not know how the time is passing on, you know.
Thank you.
I had a lady today, she is going to be on 7th of November, my Women Power Lead. She said, 1 hour of what I will do. I said, we don't know how this 1 hour passes. And hands off to you, Rajivji. Now, I have finally the vote of thanks by a gentleman called In Narula, who is a Thai Sikh born in Thailand, 4 generations in the country in Thailand, but he purely speaks, Punjabi, Gurbani, and he's of course the director of my company as well, Thailand. Achan, Sawadi Kap, your vote of thanks, Nakap. You have to unmute yourself. Achan.
Okay. Yes, can you hear me now, sir?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, let me begin. First of all, greetings to both of you and all the ladies and gentlemen. congratulations to the very proud grandfather, Sir Rajiv Kanwar.
Thank you, Nirula ji.
You're welcome.
ਚੰਗਾ ਲੱਗ ਰਿਹਾ ਤੁਹਾਡੀ ਆਵਾਜ਼ ਸੁਣ ਕੇ ਔਰ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਚੰਗਾ ਲੱਗ ਰਿਹਾ ਕਿ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਪੰਜਾਬੀ ਵੀ ਬੋਲ ਲੈਂਦੇ ਹੋ
ਹਾਂਜੀ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਜੀ ਬਿਲਕੁਲ ਚਲੋ ਐਂਡ ਬਿਫੋਰ ਆਈ ਗੋ ਔਨ ਆਈ ਵੁੱਡ ਲਾਈਕ ਟੂ ਆਲਸੋ ਟੇਕ ਦਿਸ ਓਪਰਚੁਨਿਟੀ ਟੂ ਵੈਲਕਮ ਯੂ ਟੂ ਬੈਂਕੋਕ ਥਾਈਲੈਂਡ ਵੈਨ ਦ ਸਕਾਈਜ਼ ਓਪਨ ਅਪ ਜ਼ਰੂਰ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਆ ਕੇ ਮਿਲਣਾ ਜੀ ਬੈਂਕੋਕ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਬਹੁਤ ਬਹੁਤ
ਖੁਸ਼ੀ ਹੋਵੇਗੀ ਜੀ 100% ਬਖਸ਼ੀ ਜੀ ਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਹੀ ਆਵਾਂਗਾ
Rajiv Karwal for a very insightful knowledge of entrepreneurship. You allowed us to understand and explore your mindset. Thank you. These are the key learnings. I'm going to keep it very brief, sir. Your dad is in the Air Force, and through which you have learned to decide and to be disciplined. So making decision is very important. And once you make the decision, you stick by it, being very disciplined. You have also learned to work very hard, because at the end of the day, prosperity is equal to 99% perspiration and 1% inspiration. And when you have given your best, ladies and gentlemen, the mindset should be, let me give it a little more. Yeah. You have also learned the art of interpersonal relationship. Respect all. You can talk to everyone, be it the senior most managers or be it the lowest of the low within the co-workers, within the echelon. Be sincere, be willing to learn, and have an ownership mentality. As Krishna Maruti once said, co-workers' attitude should be owning without possessing. You also have taught us to know your product and know yourself. Know your product so well that you internalize it so that there is no need for you to memorize it.
Oh, beautiful.
Now, when it comes to knowing yourself, you must ask few questions. What is it that you want from life? What do you want to be in 5 years' time? Once you know your vision, purpose, and goals, you will not waste time and energy on the drama of life because you know where you want to go. And very importantly, in the process of knowing yourself, cultivate a habit of always speaking the truth, no matter how small they are. My grandfather have always taught me, and he is echoing in my mind, "Galle ve ke loki bhul gaye ne, sach da ki maza aaya." And also the fourth thing, never give up. Every time you fail, you must tell yourself that you are that much closer to success. Learn from it and move on. Face adversities and challenges with a warrior spirit. Identify problems, find solution and move forward to be successful and to prosper. Understand the power of now. Learn what is relevant because it will make you successful today. Let me in the end wish you and your family the very best of life. May God bless you and your family forever and always. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank you, Sir Achan Rajiv Karwal.
Thank you. That was beautiful. Achan is our, we call Achan as Acharya, as a professor. He is a well-known name in the leadership coaching. This roadmap to success, public program, of mine, which is a signature program. He is my co-facilitator, along with Padmashri Pritam Singh, who is no more now. We lost him a couple of months back. And Achan is again a very, very damn great facilitator and a coach and a trainer. He has also trained in India, LG, Philips, a couple of more companies. He came to India, comes regularly to train here. in India with me. So that is what Acharyan is. I don't know. I have no words to express. Thanks to you, Mr. Rajiv Karwal. And I tell you, such a fascinating session. I want to give a standing ovation.
Thank you.
Such a great person. It has been really...
Ashrikalji, both, both, shukriya.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Nurulaji. Thank you.
Thank you, Ji. Thank you.
It's been a learning experience to be with you this evening and learn a lot. And
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sanji. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tina. Thank you.
Yeah, he was fantastic. On the core of my heart, I would like to thank you and I wish you all the best. Now you're a grandfather. There's another beauty of life which goes on in terms of, you know, when we move towards...
Sir, I have a question. Rather, I need a help. Raji, sir, am I audible to you?
Yes,
Tina,
tell me.
Raji, sir, recently I have started working on entrepreneurial culture and I'm studying the entrepreneurial culture and resultant mindset among students who are pursuing various professional courses across Indian educational institutions. Vis-a-vis, I'm comparing the culture with the UK-based students. It's a research study. And there is a professor, Kaushik, from Sheffield Business School, who is, again, a part of the study. And he's helping me out in collecting the data from the various students. So as far as entrepreneurship is considered. So my respondents here are administrative people who include vice chancellors, assistant professors, professors, etc. And students, of course. So can you please share some insights? I mean, as far as data collection is concerned, can I share my questionnaire with you?
Sure,
you, I can get the response sheets from administrative class. That it's very difficult to reach out this class because in this difficult time, I'm not able to manage connections from Srinagar. I'm in Srinagar right now.
You take my email ID from Bakshi Ji.
I will share his email ID. Please send it on his email ID.
Surely. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much. People in Brisbane, good night. And people in Canada.
Good night, sir.
Good day.
Thank you, Bakshi Ji. We'll connect. Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you for
good
a wonderful
night.
Session. Okay, Sasrikal, Rula Ji. Tanu Milange, Bangkok Chi Milange.
Milange Ji Tanu.
Hanji, Hanji.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ji. Thank you. Thank you, Ji. Bye bye.
Okay, we're logging off. All the best. We'll meet soon.
ต้องไม่ก็สรุปสั้นๆไม่ต้องยาวให้ก็คุยกันเดียว